Ladies and gentlemen, the next session we receive an honor from our new Bangkok Governor, Dr. Chatchat Sithipan, who will deliver his speech on reopening Thailand. So Dr. Chatchat is the current elected governor of Bangkok Metropolitan with an extensive background gained through previous position held as a faculty member at Chulalongkorn University, Minister of Transportation of Thailand, and CEO of Q House. Dr. Chatchat is expertised in many sectors, including engineering, executive management, policies, and politics. In this session, Dr. Chatchat will discuss about the positioning of Bangkok in world tourism, beautiful architecture, historical sites, shopping centers, accommodation, and other strengths, as well as international recognition of Bangkok tourism. He will also be discussed about the key policies and focus areas for transforming Bangkok initiative and event for promoting Bangkok tourism and economy. Mr. Dr. Chatchat will also give an overview and insightful session on how to rebrand Bangkok to respond to the needs of modern tourists. Ladies and gentlemen, may I now invite Dr. Chatchat Sithipan on the stage, please.
เอาเลยนะครับโอเคGood morning, everyone. I'm a little bit excited and nervous because when you talk about Bangkok governor, you talk about garbage cleaning.Garbage collection and traffic jam, you know, you don't talk about economy with the Bangkok governor. And look at the three speakers this morning, maybe I'm the least qualified. But okay, I try my best for this. All right, I was the CEO of the listed company before Q House, but never invited to this forum. But when I became a governor, which not related much to economy, but in fact, after my talk, you might change your mind. I think the governor hasBig role in bringing new hope to the city and to Thailand. I think the theme of today's speech will be reopening Bangkok. And as Bangkok governor, I have to ask myself, are we ready? Are we ready to open in the Bangkok for tourists? Right now, you see the increasing in number of tourists, but are we ready for the post-COVID in the healthcare system? And we look through all the numbers, and I think this is the COVID case in Bangkok, right? You see the declining number daily. This one is using the ATK test. So right now, the number will be around 2,000 cases per day, right? And you see the spike, but the trend of the peak is declining. So I think we are quite okay with the number. And when you look at other numbers related to the COVID-19 in Bangkok,Right, it is a bed occupancy, right? I mean, this one is overall bed in Bangkok. I think the occupancy rate is already 35.2% for the COVID bed, right? So we have ample capacity to handle if we have some surge in the case of COVID in the future. And you see the level, this one is more like the green and to the red. So, and look at only for Bangkok bed, right? I mean, for the Bangkok hospital.Overall, we have occupancy about 33%. Like level 3, the severe case, we have like 41%, right? Level 2.1 with a cannula with some oxygen feeder, 82%, but we can expand it. And the green, we have only 25%. So I think bed capacity more than enough to handle even the future surge from the incoming of the tourist. And I think the medicine that we need, like Favi or Monopivaria, Paxlovid, I think we have more than enough, right? I mean, the consumption rate is about 1,500 patients per day. We have more than like 1.5 weeks supplies. And now we can order by ourselves beginning next month. So So I think the supply of the medicine would be more than enough. I think vaccination is quite interesting. The number of vaccinated people are very high in Bangkok, right? I mean, two doses, we got more than 100% of the two dose coverage, like 110%, because we have unregistered population too. And you look at the third dose, we have like 70%. And you look at the aging population, 60 and above, which is the risky group of population, we have more than 50% of vaccination for the third dose. So I think vaccination is very, very well covered in Bangkok. So I think we are quite, and you see the number of the red bed, which is like severe case, going down. Only maybe the elderly and with some disease, chronic disease, is the one who occupy the red beds. So with all, and we learn a lot from the last 3 years, and we improve our healthcare system to handle the next pandemic, right? I mean, we learn about the primary care, how to cooperate among different units for the healthcare system. So after all this number, I think we are ready. From now on, I think Bangkok ready to open for the tourists and for all the business. And I think we quite confident on this. And I think we have improved many aspects and lots of collaboration. So this, my session will be maybe give you idea of the six topic, right? I mean, Bangkok 101 just give you some idea if you're not familiar with Bangkok and how we operate as a BMA. I think our office, we call ourselves BMA, Bangkok Metropolitan Authority, and then why you need to invest in Bangkok. And what can we do better? What should be the improvement? And what is our strategy as a BMA to improve our efficiencies in providing service to all the people and all investors who come here, and what are the key projects that have we done? And there's some issues that you might have some questions that might impact some investment or some companies. I think there are some concerning issues that maybe I briefly describe. So there are six topics that I will describe today. Bangkok 101, maybe just give you some idea, right? We have registered population about 5.5 million, but including unregistered, maybe 8.5 or 10 million. So it's the biggest city. We are primate city. The second largest city would be maybe Nakhon Ratchasima, maybe only 2 million. Some say that Bangkok is the largest primate city in the world. It's good and bad, right? For the good, everything is here. So you don't miss anything if you come to Bangkok. So our infrastructure, all the investment is here in Bangkok. The budget of BMA is quite limited, right? So we are different from like New York or Tokyo. Bangkok BMA has maybe only 79 billion baht budget, comparing to 3.2 trillion of the government budget, right? So our budget is only like 2.6% of the government budget, but we take care of like 12% of the population. So as I said, don't expect BMA to do a lot on economy, but we have other aspects to improve. No? But because like in Bangkok, even the police is separate to other units, controlled by the police sector. Even healthcare, Bangkok, BMA has only 12% of the beds, hospital beds in Bangkok. It either is controlled by the health ministry, controlled by the universities, right? So the limited budget of Bangkok also have some constraint on our operation. We have about like 1,300 square kilometer divided into 50 districts and 180 sub-districts. We have only a small seashore about 5 kilometers in Bang Khun Thian area, you see on the lower side. But Bangkok is, as I said, it's a center of economic activities, right? I mean, the GDP of Bangkok is like 32% of the GDP. And if including the greater Bangkok, right, other five provinces, we account for nearly 50% of the GDP of the country. So if you want to improve or if you want to look at the economy, look at Bangkok and its surrounding areas. It will be a good indicator for the future. Actually, now you can see the trend in the future. I would expect the GDP of Bangkok to increase because of a lot of the people moving to the city more, and then you have creative economy. So I think a lot of activity will happen in Bangkok more than in the province in the coming future, right? I mean, you see the top seven industries that are accountable for 80% of Bangkok economy, like wholesale, public accommodation, information and communication, financial, manufacturing and transportation. Now, why you want to come to Bangkok for investment? As a governor, I would like you all to come to invest here, but what is the strength of Bangkok? As I said, we are the major economic activity in Thailand, right? We account for 32% of GDP. And we have the greatest demand in all provinces, like I think up to maybe 10 million, including unregistered population. And I think this is quite interesting figure. The vertical axis is the quality of living index, and the horizontal one is cost of living, right? Bangkok, we have quite not a high, we have a competitive cost of living index, right? 106 comparing to 181 overall. So we comparing to other countries, we still in the middle. So I think it's also the community advantage that you look at the cost of living in Bangkok, it's quite attractive comparing to other major cities like Singapore. Sorry, Excellency. I think Excellency Ambassador Kevin, hello. Okay, I might have to mention Singapore sometimes. So like Singapore, good quality of life, but still high cost of living, right? So I think there are some good and bad that put some strength to Bangkok too, right? I think you see infrastructure improving. Like we see a lot of mass transit completing soon. We might have like 450 kilometers of mass transit in the next three or four years. So if you have chance to live around the CBD, I think your life will be much easier to commute. And you see, Bangkok has a long history, right? We become the capital for like 240 years. And with a rich history, you see a lot of culture thing in the city too, right? We start from Canal Road and a lot of trading activities. And you see many attractions in Bangkok, deep history. So you can enjoy both life, work, and leisure in the same time in the vicinity of Bangkok. So this may be the charming of Bangkok that attracts so many people here. I think another interesting thing that after I went to many districts in Bangkok, we are truly multicultural society, right? I mean, you can see that we have so many religions staying together. We have church, we have mosque, we have temple, we have like Chinese spirit house all together in one area, and we live together in harmony. And you can see this so many areas, and that's why we have a so multicultural history and lots of attraction in Bangkok. Right, and I think if you see in the near coming years, 2 years, I think you see more office space in Bangkok, right? A lot of being built. Now we might have nearly 10 million square meters. Right now, maybe we have about 8.2, 8.3 million square meters of office space. But in the coming years, you have many more because we have quite a few projects going on. The one Bangkok, to say Central Park, and we have Makassar Complex, which link to the EEC project. So you see a lot of office space available for, hopefully, in the future, maybe more multinational corporation move to Bangkok with this available of the office space. And the office space, maybe it's not good, but I think it's maybe, our office space is quite low, the rental, comparing to other countries, right? Like if you look at Hong Kong, like $250 per square foot per year, Bangkok only $44 per square foot per year. Right, so I mean, I think the cost of renting office much lower, and we have ample supply. So hopefully this one might be something good for business to move. You look at other things like cultural thing, leisure, work, life balance, and good cost of living here. So maybe that's one thing that Bangkok would be the good destination for investing. And I mean, for tourists, we have a lot of hotel room available, 160,000 hotel rooms, and the price is quite low comparing to other competitive cities, right? And now we have three world-class conventions in Bangkok and in vicinity. We have Bitec, we have Queen Sirikit, which just renovated, and we have big areas that we can attract many exhibition and conference and also impact Mueang Thanh, even though it's not in Bangkok, in vicinity. So all this will be the strength of Bangkok in the future to attract more investment and more tourism, more MICE activity. And so you look at the decline. Right now, I would say last year will be the first year that we have declining population, right? Because I mean, declining a little bit, but maybe the first time in history. But we still have plenty of workforce that can help us from our neighboring countries, right? I mean, you look at the workforce that construction and in other area. So we connect to our neighbor and we provide opportunities for them. So I think we don't have too much worry about workforce in the future because we connect to our neighboring countries. Right now they are accounted for nearly 10% of the total workforce. And I think we have a good healthcare system. Look at the COVID, the past COVID, right? We rank number 28. The lower, the better. And for the COVID infection and death rate, we like 32%. So I think our healthcare handle the pandemic pretty well. And I think it can create trust for the coming future. But what can we do better? I think there's a good and also the bad, right? I mean, there are ease of doing business. I think we are not as high as we wish, like we are number 21. I think the problem would be the rule of law, the regulation that still need a lot of steps to get the license. I think the BMA is part of the problem too. So we have to improve our efficiency in the business process. Corruption would be the biggest issue, I think. We have to admit it, right? I mean, we're ranking 110 comparing to 180, and it's getting worse, not getting better. So as a BMA, we have to be serious about this. Maybe it's one of the first issues that we have to be very, very serious about it to gain the trust and confidence back. You know? So I think corruption would be the thing that we have to start looking at it. I think the proficiency in English is low, right? I mean, ranking number 100 comparing to 112 countries. That's a big problem. So as a BMA school, so we have to improve the quality of the school, actually in language, in the technical knowledge, right? The skill required for future workforce, we are quite low comparing to other country, right? Critical thinking, we are ranking number 89 from 141. Pupil to teacher, ranking number 56. So all this has to be in our strategy to improve the quality of the school in the BMA. The quality of life, right? We have PM 2.5 issues. Like now you are happy, but wait until November, December, you see more PM 2.5 coming. And we have to be serious about that, right? Because I'll tell you later why the quality of life is so important for the future of the city. Right, I mean, the traffic jam, right? I mean, but I think we're getting better. We used to be at number one, but now we're number 11, right? Maybe because of the COVID. But still, we spend like 71 hours per year on the road in Bangkok. But I mean, I'm not intending to solve traffic jam in Bangkok, but I want to improve mobility. So we have to not focus on the car, but focus on the alternative of transportation, like you have to walk better, you have to use the public transport better. And we have low green space per capita. I think the WHO require like 9 square meter per person. Right now we have 6.9 square meter. Many of them are rice field too, you know, in Nong Chok or in other area. So when you look only usable green space, we have only like 1 square meter per person, comparing to 9 square meter required by the WHO, right? So I think we have to improve on this green space. And maybe the land tax would be one of the solution. We put the land tax and then people maybe can give the land for us to develop the green space temporarily, maybe 7-10 years until they need the land and get it back. So I think we need to improve on the public space, on the green area. So what is our strategies? What is the BMA strategy to look at this problem, actually for the thing that we need to improve? That's the number in Bangkok. That I think this one we use it for when we develop our policy. So these two belongs to Bangkok. Number one is that we are number one tourist destination. We are the most visited city in the world, like by MasterCard. But number 98 is a livability index. Comparing to 140, we are 98. So we are good for short-term visit, right? You can come stay here for 1 week, enjoy the amazing Thailand, amazing Bangkok. But to stay here for a year, maybe not so pleasant, right? So how can we improve 98? How can we be a more livable Bangkok, right? And that's the key thing that we don't need to be so smart, but we want to be more livable, like people have a better quality of life. So we need to improve the number 98. Number one is good. We have a tourist industry. right? So the vision of Bangkok, we want Bangkok just to be a livable city for all. If you don't have for all, it's easy, right? When you make Bangkok livable, I think many of us here feel that Bangkok is livable. But you talk about other people, other Bangkok population. So we need to think for everyone. Bangkok has to be inclusive for everyone. So I think the key word would be livable city for all. So with this, we look at EIU index. EIU is an organization that measures the livability index for all the cities. They have 30 in this, but we use it and we develop 9 guiding policies, right, to make it a livable city for all. So we have environment, health, mobility, safety, management, infrastructure, economy, creativity, and learning. So these are the key guiding policies for us to develop the framework for Bangkok in the future. And with this framework, so these are the guidelines that we are doing, right? I mean, the environment and the safety, the economic, health, management in the center, the creativity, the mobility, the infrastructure, and the education system. So with all this, we put our policy in. And I think maybe during our campaign, right, I mean, three months ago, we put every policy in English too. So we welcome the comments from our friends who come here, our visitors. We want to get the comment from them. So you look at our policy, we put our policy on the website, and we have 216 action plans to respond to this policy. Right. So I mean, if you have time, take a look at our policy, and then you can see the details of our action plan. And they are like, and I think it's dynamic, no? Not limit only 216. Right now, maybe 220 already. So we increasing dynamic according to the situation. And I think we can get the feedback from you. So I think these all action plans are there, and you can take a look and see what we are planning to do in this coming weeks, months, and years. Right. And we can divide into 28 programs, right? Open Bangkok, traffic, city planning, all this, the category of these 216 action plans, right? So I think the strategic direction for the economic side, I think right now we focus maybe on the 7 things, right? Creative economy or maybe startup. Tourism, I think it's our main income for the last decade. Health and wellness. Jewelry also another thing that we have export of nearly 500 billion Thai baht each year for jewelry, mice, right? I mean, we have hotel, we have exhibition center, hubs of MNC. I think in the future, we have to compete for the MNC multinational corporations to come to Bangkok and use Bangkok as a hub. And I think EEC, when you talk to EEC, you don't think much about Bangkok, right? But I think Bangkok will be the one who get most benefits from EEC. And we have to grab that opportunity. We have to extend our business activity to the east and then include EEC in our action plans too, right? I think, for example, Jatuchak Marketplace, if you've been there, we try to drive it to be the world-class destination. We put new committee in who is more like in the creative industry business and then try to improve and make it both analog and digital market. Right. We try to improve made in Bangkok product, create the platform both analog and digital, and increase the marketability of made in Bangkok products. Right. Support Thailand to be jewelry sourcing destination. Yesterday, just go to the opening announcement of the ceremony to held the exhibition of Bangkok jewelry sourcing destination. So this kind of thing that is already there. The bank BMA has to help them improve and then help collaborate with all these business entities to promote their activities, right? And to attract more MNCs from other cities. And I think the problem is Bangkok have a quality of living in the middle. So I think the focus of us to improve the quality of living up to the red region with the cost of living remain competitive, right? So in that case, we can compete more with Singapore or more with Hong Kong. But we need to improve the quality of life in Bangkok. We have many festivals, right? We try to have a festival every month to create economic activities for all the people, including the grassroots. We have a movie activity, which hopefully in the future can be listed in the world calendar, competing with other world events, right? And as I said, when you look at the EEC project, right, we have the high-speed train connecting three airports, Don Mueang, Suvarnabhumi, and Utapao. And you look at the station of these high-speed trains, more than half is in Bangkok. Only maybe 4 or 5 are situated outside Bangkok. So I think we have to grab this opportunity and try to create the plan that maybe the new town, you know, you look at the high-speed train connecting Bangkok to Utapao. You see a lot of region in the east coast, east portion of Bangkok, close to this EEC. And you see the city is migrating to the east right now. You see more opportunities happening in Suvarnabhumi area, in Lai Kabang, in Nong Jok area. So I think we have to include ourselves in the EEC project and then try to take advantage of it. Because people won't stay far away from Bangkok. They will say in Bangkok, we have good school, good hospitals. Create new city to compete with Bangkok, not easy. So I think maybe we try to improve our capacity to serve EEC more. So I think we have to develop our plan and then to get the benefit from EEC projects. So what are the key projects that we have been doing or we plan to do, right? When you talk about city, what is a city? I think the good definition of city is just primarily a labor market. So without work, there will be no city. So we have to create good works in the city. And it's our role to try to promote that, to bring good company, to bring good investment to Bangkok, right? I mean, Professor Edward Glaser in Harvard put it well, right? In the future, we're not competing for infrastructure. We're not competing for like a BTS or mass transit, but we're competing for talents. So the city has to attract talents to the city, and that's the only way we can survive. If we cannot bring good people, smart people in, we cannot bring smart business in, the city will die. So I think that's our role as a city, to improve quality of life, because when you are talents, when smart people, you can choose where you live. So I think the role of the city is to attract smart people and enable them to work collaboratively. So we might not have to design what the city will be. The smart people, smart business will help us design, but we have to provide ecosystem that bring them in to Bangkok. So I think the duty of Bangkok, only 4 things. You have to increase productivity. You not be the burden for the business to do in Bangkok. You have to improve quality of life. You have to create opportunity for all, because we have inequality in the city for sure, and they have to build trust. I think the last word is the most important job of the city. You have to create trust for business to come in. You have to create hope for the people that they have good future. So as we start the program with Open Bangkok, right? I think the transparency comes with opening data. So now we start to put everything online. So you can see like the budget we just passed last week, we put our budget online for the first time in history of BMA, you know, put the budget online during the reading of the council, put in the format that we can use. So we put the budget online in the CSV and Excel format. And then there are many people who grab this data and interpret that for us, you know. So this is done by other people, like the new generation, who like to see how we spend money. So we just put the data there without any cost, and then people analyze this data for us. They track what money has been used, in which way. So transparency just come by opening data, and that really helped the way we do business, you know. And with the data, I mean, they do it in detail, where the money goes, and they're tracking them. So I think the first way to fight corruption, to improve transparency is to open data to all. And that costs nothing, just the mindset, right? So I issue the executive order that all units have to put the data in the readable format, not in the PDF file. Usually we put it in the PDF file, right? So it's like a copy machine that useless to use the data in the future. So it should be a readable file. And then with this, people come and explore our data. So I think the strategy for Bangkok would be open data, open contracting, open policy, open innovation, and open space. Just change the mindset. Let people see what you are doing. And this, I think, will improve the efficiency of the city for sure. So I think now we will open the contract that we have with all the companies online, right? The policy is already there. We have 216 policies. People now following, have we done as we promised? what is the progress of each policy. With this, I mean, you can see increased transparency immediately and innovation, and we provide more space for people to have dialogue and talk. So I think the open Bangkok would be transparency, accountability, and participatory. So the coming budget next year, because this year we have limited time to do it. Next year we have a participatory budgeting. We will let people involved in deciding what they want. We have zero budgeting, like, because sometimes we just use the budget of last year, increase 5% for the next year, right? So we try to do zero budgeting for a certain department and certain district to improve the efficiency of the budget allocation. Anyone use this before? Traffic from do. Nobody use it? No, there, use it. So traffic from do is an amazing thing, you know. It really changed the way we work in BMA. Traffic from do is the application, just the mobile application. It has developed by the Ministry of Science long time ago, like three or four years ago, but nobody use it. So it's just the application that you can take pictures of the problem you see in Bangkok. You see the problem with the footpath or the street or the flooding, you take a picture and you send it to BMA. So it will put the location, the GPS location, and it will tell you which district this problem is, and you can write a small description to inform the problem. We call it traffic from so simple, you know. Everyone has a mobile phone, you can take picture, okay, you see the communication line, so bad, take picture, send it. And the problem report to the center. So how it changed? How it changed the way we're doing business in BMA, right? I mean, usually in BMA, we have a silos. I mean, as many civil service organizations, we have department, we have district, not connected together, so everybody's silo. So we use digital technology to penetrate these silos and make it more efficient. So there's no silo, so everything is seamless, connecting through digital platform. Previously, we do business as a pipeline, right? We had the problem. Because right now, if I go jogging every morning, and people know that I jog in the morning, right? So there will be people waiting for me. Governor, and send me the letter. I have a problem at my house, right? So people send me the letter while I jog, so I receive the citizen problem to the governor. So after I read, okay, Deputy Governor, you handle this. Deputy Governor, okay, the Permanent Secretary, go. So there's a line of command, and it might take 2 months to solve the problem, because we have pipeline connecting. And that's a civil servant. A civil servant, we always do this, right? I have to sign many documents, right? Sometimes it takes 1.5 months for the document to reach me. They have like 12 signatures before. So they have like, I think you know that if you are in the private, you might not experience this, right? But if you are in the civil servant sector, you see that there are so many people before you. Maybe take 1.5 months for the letter to reach me, because you have the pipeline for the thing to go. And sometimes if you have big pipe, you have good connection, your problem will be solved quickly. But if you are the like grassroots, you don't know anyone, your pipe will be very small, you know. So it goes very slow, sometimes got stuck somewhere. So very inefficient. But that's the way we do business in the civil servant sector, right? In the public sector. I think this is the way that there's a problem. Why so delay in solving the problem for BMA? Some problem remain there for years, never been fixed. Sometimes the problem report just under the carpet and nobody see it, right? So when you change this to platform, from pipeline to platform, I think business done this long time ago. When you see Amazon, you see eBay, you see PayPal, it's a platform that you just throw your demand in and people will grab the demand and provide service for you. So there's no pipeline connecting. You just throw what you want in the platform. So the traffic from do change the way we do business, right? From pipeline to platform. So when people send the problem in, it appears on the platform. You can see all these are complaints from Bangkok people. The first day we opened Traffic from do, right? This application. The first day I was confirmed by the Kokotor, the election committee. There are 20,000 report, you know. They crash our website because we don't expect that gonna be that so many people complain. And up today, right, for today, there are 131,000 complaints 3 months through this traffic fondue, right? 131,000 complaints through this application. And we solve it, like 70,000, we already solve it. Without me ordering any signature, you know. I don't have to order anything, because once it's on the platform, you see every officer see, every district know that this year. And we know how long it stay there. So I know which district is more efficient, which district is delay, right? So, and this one is really increase the transparency and increase the productivity of the Bangkok. It changed the mindset of the civil servant in each department, because they cannot wait, they have to solve the problem. And it costs us nothing. The application is free, done by someone else. The fixing of the problem is also, we have to fix it anyway. But instead of 2 months, we fix it in 1 day. So the same budget, and it really changed the way people do business in BMS. So I think some simple technology really changed the way we work, you know, and it improved the quality. And just a simple thing. And I think this one is truly democratic system, right? Because each complaint, you don't know it's a friend of me or who, because it's a binary, it's just a digital. So in digital, in binary, everyone is equal. There's no the friend of governor there. We don't know which one is the friend of governor. You have to treat each complaint equally. So that's a really true democratic system. And it improved the trust of the people to our service. You know? So I think the 3 months you see lots of change with just introduction of this application and the commitment from the management that you have. And I know, this district, why it's so delayed? And now it expands not only to Bangkok, because there are many other services connected to Bangkok, like police, the Metropolitan Electric Authority, MEA, the water. So now they all connect to this traffic fondue. So if the problem comes, so we can directly connect to them, and they solve the problem. So now traffic fondue expand to other organizations too, and really change the way we are working now, right? And each district, they have to dedicate like 3 persons to look at traffic fondue. Every morning, they look how many reports had been fixed, who gonna fix it, and then respond quickly. So this is the way we change the visit. One-stop service, I think when you have to visit so many people for approval, that causes corruption because you have lots of personal judgment, right? So we provide one-stop service that you just put document in one location and get approval through the process. And I think this one might sound simple, right? We have when the first time I came 3 months ago, we have music in the park. It used to be there, but maybe not lots of promotion or activities. But we start movies, the music in the park every week in many parks, you know. And it really increased the spirit of the people, you know. They feel that a city is more pleasant. They have activity other than going to the department store. So lots of things going on, and I think the people happy with such a simple thing, you know. You see the value of the public space, you see the beautifulness of the city, and you can enjoy life, and then people feel that the city has already changed. Just some simple things that's going on. And we have like a movie in the park and create lots of economic activity from the street vendors. Like something that we don't have to invest anything, but it really changed the spirit, the feeling of the people. And I think this is the way that we unite people together. We just have now the festival this month will be science and festival technology. So you see many things going on around Bangkok about technology and festival with cooperation of from many, many companies, right? We start to look at the creative districts. For each district, have local identity, start put some creativity in it, and now we can create another destination for economic or tourism, right? So we look at many districts. We expect for 50 districts and then create a creative economy into this district, maybe more tourists and then more products coming out. And then we will start joining with the private sector, right? We can do the Goro, or used to be in the country level, never been in the province level before. But now we will create Goro or Gotamo Bangkok Joint Committee. Because I think I'm sure that the driving force of Bangkok is not BMA, but more on the private sector. They create more jobs, they create many opportunities. So we have to work with them and see the direction. So we don't know what Bangkok should be in the future. We have to talk to the investors, talk to the private sector, and give us the idea and then work together, right? So we collaborate with the Federation of Thai Industry, Board of Trade, and the Thai Banker Association. And then we have the joint committee coming soon, maybe next week or coming two or three weeks. Yeah. I think after this, I think the trust will be the key thing that we have to provide. We may not be providing many fancy things for the city, but we have to create trust. And it's the future, the currency of the future. Yesterday, I happened to meet the president of Mini Bear Company. Yeah, he just came to visit. We know during the flooding time, I was the Minister of Transport, right? And I talked to him, and then Mini Bear is expanding a lot in Bangkok, in Thailand, right? They're investing a lot. I asked him why you invest so much in Bangkok? Why don't you move? Because he experienced big problem during the flood, right? Mini Bear during the flood last time, 2014. And he said, because we treat him well, we give him confidence that time. So he trusts us, he wants to be part of us, you know. So look at the Mini Bear, after the big flood, he's still employing, he's still investing more and more. Right now they're employing like 38,000 employees, creating lots of economy, creating more factories. Why? Because they have trust in us. So I think the future role of Bangkok, I think we have to create trust for the people that we're ready to help them, we're not the burden for them. So come to Bangkok and we will help them and collaborate with them. So I think trust will be the key thing that we have to create. Right, I mean, you see a lot of opportunities and then happiness. Oh, this one is music in the park, right? So what is the ongoing issues? There are some issues that investors might be worried. And I think now the one thing that really changed the way we collect tax would be the land and building tax, right? We used to collect tax on revenue. We call it Phasi Rong Ruen, which is we calculate from the revenue of the land. If you rent the house, you collect 12.5% from that revenue. But now we change that scheme to the property and land tax. So no matter how much you gain the revenue from the property, you get taxed by the evaluation of the value. So it really changed the way we do tax, you know. It happened during the COVID, we reduced it. The government reduced it 10%, but now we fully put it to fully 100%. So you see this impact onto some companies soon. And at the BMA, we will fully collect them as much as possible. Right now, we have only 60% of database being done. But I think the coming year, we will increase the collecting rate to be 100%. So you see more. And because the two schemes is totally different, you know. The first scheme is based on the revenue. The second scheme based on the evaluation of your value. So these two tax might be totally different. So the cost incurred to the company might be different. So you have to think carefully about this. And you can see this in many land in Bangkok. Especially from in the central district, you see many banana plants. Don't be surprised, it's just to avoid tax, you know. If you plant enough banana trees, you get less tax. No? That's the Thai system. Because they have some rules that if you plant this banana tree number, you will become an agricultural land, so you get very low tax. So you see this part of land a lot in CBD. And we try to solve this problem, try to get the real tax from them, but not issue resolved yet. So we are working on this. So I think land and property tax will be one thing that in this coming year we have some effect on the companies, right? The zoning will be changed, right? I mean, we have the zoning of the city plan. Existing, it's supposed to be coming out this year, but because of the change of the law, it had to go back and then restart the process. So it may take another 2 years for the city planning to get to the new draft. So it takes some time. But as I said, we see more development on the east side of Bangkok because connecting to the EEC. So this zoning, not in effect yet, but soon it will come in effect. So you have to look at this. It might affect your land bank and your future development. And I think we have some issues about the Green Line project. I think many investors will be concerned. So I think at the BMA, we have to be fair to every stakeholders. So it might take a little bit of time because there are many parties involved, right? I mean, there are like council, member council, BMA council member that we have to consult and we have to look at the law and regulation. So it might take maybe a few weeks or months to get the issue resolved, but we will be fair to everyone. So these are three ongoing issues. So I think the key success factor after 3 months, we know that we don't have so much resources, BMA itself, right? We have limited budget, we have limited authority. But I think the success will be in the collaboration process with other entity, other private sectors and stakeholders. So during the last 3 months, we have been consulting with many people, right? BMA, academic side, industry or private sector and the citizen. So we're joining hands together. And I think we really changed the way we're doing business. You see lots of united coming. We are like united together, right? We start the first day, we go to anti-corruption. I think that's our first issue. We have to be transparent. We have to address corruption seriously. Otherwise, we cannot bring trust to the city hall. Right? And then we go to many things like federal Thai industries, National Housing Authority, another issue that we have to think, DGA, like transforming the government to be digital, right? Trade of Thailand, the NSTDA technology. So we talk to many, many people, and I think collaboration will be the key thing. And I would like to hear from all the private sectors and the companies too, because I think you know better than us in many areas. So I think we have to listen to you and then join forces together, and we help you, and you help us in providing the better city. So I think this is important too. After 3 months, right, I talked to my staff, and I talked to, the council member of the BMA too. I think our task during the last 3 months that I talked to people, and our task right now is not limited only to the BMA or to the city itself. But I think we have to restore trust, confidence, and hope in the democratic system. I think if we do it well, if our team do well, if the council member do well, we can restore trust in the democracy system, which I think a lot of Thai people lost that confidence during the last decade, you know. So I think we have to prove that election democracy is still powerful. It can still be the solution for the city. You can have good policy, you have good solution, you can bring city better through this process. So I think our job is not only for the city, but for the system as a whole. I think that's bigger than our role right now. So I think we try to do our best, and hopefully you can see change in Thailand politics. Hopefully we can see change. We can see that people will focus more on policies, on people-centric. You know, I think the politics will change. I think new generation will join. Because me as an independent candidate, we can accomplish this with good policy, good thinking, good team. So I think anyone can do it. So hopefully our mission is not only for Bangkok. And I mean, yesterday I went to the one event, you know, and this kid like hugged me, you know. I mean, hug me more than my kid, my son, ever did to me, you know. Hug me, and I think that's what we are doing, you know. We have to provide future for our kids. We have to hand a good city to our kids, not the polluted one, not the corrupted one. We have to land a good city to them. And that's our task today, all right. So hopefully, in the future, we can make Bangkok a lovable city for all, and we cannot do it on ourselves. We have to join hands and work together. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chachat, for a very fruitful information. So Bangkok is now ready for reopening.